Welcome to Gotta Go. This is Will Sanchez. My special guest tonight is Sworupa Khadka, also known as Swoops. What a great nickname. I heard about Swoops from a mutual friend, Ming, sometimes known as Merciful Ming. I was at the Streakers event at Roadrunners, and Ming came up to me, "You should have Swoops as a guest. She just came back from the Asian Games." When Ming says you should, I do it. So I'm delighted to have Swoops as my guest.
Thank you, Will. It's great to be here. And thanks for Ming for getting me over here to you.
Great. Let's get started by introducing yourself to our audience. Sure. For example, where were you born? And tell us a little bit about your childhood.
Sure. I was born in Kathmandu, Nepal, through high school.
Wait. Kathmandu. I mean, you always hear that name and almost don't think that people actually live there.
Yeah, it's very interesting place. Now, it's very simple in terms of anything. We grew up having eating everything organic, so I did not even know the difference between what is organic and what is not.
Wow.
Until I came to US and we heard about all these big things about natural and organic.
Oh.
Because nothing was too, it wasn't even though it was the biggest city in Nepal,
uh-huh.
but it was not urbanized.
Okay.
But we were very exposed to Western culture because because it is the tourist destination because of the mountains.
Mount Everest?
Mount Everest. And also, I think 7 or 8 of the highest peaks of the world are all in Nepal.
And Annapurna, right?
Yes, yes.
Okay, well, Annapurna and Mount Everest, everybody's heard of. Annapurna is famous for its trekking trails.
Exactly.
And of course, Mount Everest,
mm-hmm.
people like the climate. But now, was that a popular destination where you were growing up with the Sherpas involved? Did you know any of them?
Yeah, so Sherpas is basically, it's like the one of the ethnic group who actually lives in that area. So it's called the Everest region. So Namche is, it's called, Nepal is divided into different districts, like we have states over here. So one of the, it's like Solukhumbu is the region where, district where the Mount Everest falls under.
Mm-hmm.
And the people, the ethnic group lived in that area, they were the Sherpas. But it became, I think, the identifying, a lot of the people, when I tell them that, oh, I'm from Nepal, they're like, oh, you're Sherpa.
Oh, okay.
But we do not consider ourselves Sherpa because it's a different ethnic group we belong to.
Oh, okay. Well, of course, they're always in the news almost every other year because something terrible happens and they lose a lot of their lives because of the snow. And then most recently, they were trying to unionize. I don't know. What's the current status of the Sherpas? Do you know?
I do not know the details about, the unionized and everything. But because of the internet and access with all this transportation, climbing Mount Everest is not as rare as it used to be 10 years before.
Yeah.
Because you used to hear one person or two person climbing Everest 1 year or 2 year when I was growing up.
Okay.
But now you hear so many people.
I know.
And even going to the base camp or even closer to the Mount Everest is not that difficult. It's just because the access of the information, I guess. With the internet and everything.
Mm.
Seeing Mount Everest is also rare. I don't know how many people in Nepal can say they have seen Mount Everest because Kathmandu is a valley and it is surrounded by, here it's called mountains, but in Nepal we call them hills.
Uh-huh.
So whatever we call it, mountains over here, we call them hills.
Oh, okay.
And then only the snow-capped mountain like Annapurna or Mount Everest, we call them mountain.
Okay.
So because Kathmandu is surrounded by those big hills, it kind of blocked the view of Mount Everest, a lot of the mountains.
Okay.
So you have to, there's only a little outskirt of Nepal, you have to drive maybe 2 hours away to some point that where you can, you might be able to view Mount Everest,
mm-hmm.
but it's very rare too because the fog and, it has to be clear day.
Were you particularly in sport in high school?
I was always very active. I participated in every sports that the school had to offer. The only thing I did not play that was offered in my school were shot put, javelin, and discus.
So, javelin.
I was fortunate enough to be in one of the best schools in Nepal, which gave all, you know, which had all the equipment and all the opportunity to participate into all or get exposed to all these different kinds of track and field events, basketball. We had a very good basketball team at that time. Unfortunately, because I went to all girls school, for some reason we did not have soccer. So the only sport, the group sport we had was basketball and volleyball.
Uh-huh.
I tried volleyball a couple of times, but did not like it.
We're probably a little too short, even.
Yeah, but basketball, for some reason, like I did good in basketball.
Really?
But later on, you know, like because I focused myself more into track and field, so I stayed with that.
Okay.
But for volleyball, the first time I tried to hit volleyball, like maybe I hit it wrong. My wrist was like this big, and so I never got into it.
Okay. Now, in high school, how did you decide the colleges to pick?
I was surrounded by a family who are very academic, and especially my mom's family, almost everybody a doctor. So I had that mindset growing up that, oh, you know, and I was among my cousins, like my generation people, I was really good in studies and also like really good in all the extracurricular activities and everything. Mm-hmm. So the expectation was, and it's like, you know, in like the Asia, South Asia, it's like very academic because that's where you like focus, oh, what do you want to become when you grow big, and you pick something like that.
Okay.
And I thought I will go to medical school. And I kind of like, you know, in the process, after high school, in the process of applying for medical school, and I had a couple of friends who were already there into medical school. Somehow I lost, because the whole process of getting into medical school in Nepal and India is like extremely, extremely difficult. And it's like in another level. Mm-hmm. Like being smart and just like being good is not enough. You know, there are like so many other factors that gets involved
right.
into it. So I was like, I want to do something that I do not want to be obliged with my parents or somebody else to give me education. So I'm just going to do, like, you know. And my dad, and also like other members of my family, they have been all educated abroad. So I was exposed to the colleges and universities and how the education in the Western world versus, you know, in Nepal or India.
The University of Bridgeport has offered you a scholarship or something?
Yes. I knew a couple of people who went there. So they sent me the application.
So what did you study at the University of Bridgeport?
A management information systems.
MIS.
Yes.
Oh.
And I did a computer science minor too.
Oh my goodness, that's. Were you athletically active during college?
So not really. Like as everybody else comes here, like a pursue your American dream, and then just got focused on that. So the whole sports thing was not even a part of my college life.
Now you have to decide to get a job. How did you make that choice?
Whitney Bowes, that I had been working for them since summer of my junior year. Whitney Bowes, they have offered me the full time.
Yeah.
But I was still interviewing like some of them, making my choices. Fortunately, the company, Aon Hewitt, so they called me for an interview. I had no idea what their company is. I had no idea the management consulting, the retirement design and all that stuff. Went there. I liked the company, and the company was in Norwalk, Connecticut. So I lived in Stamford and mm-hmm. worked for them for 3 years.
But obviously, running became important again. How did you get back into running?
When I went to Hewitt, it was a very young company, so it was private at that time. It was like Google kind of environment at that time. It somehow leaked that information that, oh, I used to run 100 meters, 200 meters when I was in school. Like, I used to be, you know, win those races all the time.
Ah.
So there was this race in Stamford. I forgot the name of the race, but it's like the corporate challenge, but in Stamford. So they were like, okay, So we have to have a people to,
a team,
you know, team. So since you're like the runner with tall athletes, so you will be the first one on the list. I'm like, what are you talking about? And the longest distance I've raced is 400 meters.
Okay.
My reporting manager, who actually gave me that nickname, Swoops, he said, like, no. I see the competitiveness in you.
Oh, okay.
You're very ambitious. I see it in you. You're going there. So I could not say no. So I entered the race. It added me so much stress because I did not have that idea about recreational running, you know, because the only running I did was to win gold medal. So I think, and being like, you know, like the ambitious thing,
okay.
So you feel like I have to prove myself kind of,
okay.
You know, thing. So in my apartment building, there was a gym. So I started going to treadmill. We used to work long hours. So I used to get home 11:30 at night to the treadmill and run, like, you know, 5 minutes would kill me on treadmill.
Oh,
and slowly I got to like 15 minutes, you know, and 20 minutes. And I had gained a little when I came to U.S., like compared to how I was before. By the time I graduated, I gained like 10, 15 pounds too, which I had never ever been that big, you know.
But how did the race turn out, that initial, was it a 5K?
It was 5K. I just went straight out, like, you know, until I died, like, you know, to the finish line. But I think it just, like, I kept on running and running. But it was funny. I came second. The first one had 19, she's a triathlete, she's a marathon, like, she had done marathon, she's like one of the elite. I did 20 minutes and I could not believe it. Like, you know, I looked at her saying, oh my God, you know, this awesome person, she's like, everybody knows her. So, and I think that race kind of gave me confidence.
All right. So what was the first marathon that you entered?
So the first marathon I entered was Philly Marathon in 2006. And again, I have no idea how I ran the marathon. I entered the marathon. And after that, I was not like consistent runner at all. I stopped running in between. I moved to New York and I changed jobs. The whole thing went away again, you know. So the running picture was out of the scene. But like, I had watched the New York City Marathon in 2005. So I was thinking at that time when I was watching the New York City Marathon, I saw like all these older people, the family people, like, you know, all kinds of people, so energetic, so much energy. And that had hit me in my mind that one day, what am I doing? Like, you know, I want to do something, like, maybe not marathon, but at least some races like this, which has so much energy.
Yeah.
If they can do it, I can do it.
How did the Philly Marathon turn out for you?
It was, so I do not, to be honest, I do not even remember. So I might have done 3 runs, long run, before that. I signed up end of September. And then I ran in November. Of course, I was injured because I have no idea, like, what kind of shoes I was wearing. No,
oh, my goodness.
Like, I do not know what it takes to do running.
Oh, okay. But now you're an accomplished runner. So where was the big breakthrough? Was it Philly? Was it the next marathon?
It was the Marine Corps Marathon in 2010. That was the breakthrough marathon.
Oh, so the first one was Philly in 2006?
2006. So
okay,
that
so
was
4
the fundraising.
Years later.
Because I had a bad experience in Philly. So.
Oh, okay, so what happened in the Marine Corps?
But I was going to train for it this time because with the whole Philly thing.
I know. But did you have a team, a club that you were running with at that
point? Nothing at all. So what I did, as anybody, like, you know, like as I do for anything, the first thing I do is Google it. So I said marathon training program. You know, I did not know, I was not connected to any of the running people.
Okay.
I was not in that culture at
That's
all.
Right.
So
That's
I was
right.
so
okay.
away from that. So it came, like, you know, the first thing it came up, which pretty much looked good, was the Hal Higdon plan.
Okay. So you get to the starting line at the Marine Corps, ready, you did the Howe Higdon plan. How did it go?
So I thought I might run 335 or 340.
What was your time in Marathon?
320.
320.
So I crossed the finish line. I had no garment.
That's great. Well, you must have been in seventh heaven.
Yeah, so I crossed the finish. I did not have garment, nothing. Like, I did not know about the pacing thing yet.
This is amazing. But again, let's speed it up a little bit, because eventually you got invited to do the Asian Games in Nepal in 2014.
Mm-hmm.
So before you got invited to that, you must have had some more success. Tell us, what was the biggest success that got you that invitation to come to the Asian Games?
So it was the Chicago Marathon in 2013. And again, after, like, you know, New York City Marathon, I was injured. 2011, New York City Marathon, that's when I started running with Nike.
Oh, Nike Town.
Oh,
okay. So, which coach was active?
Kenley was the first person.
Oh,
she was the coordinator.
Oh,
so she was the
goodness.
First person who introduced me, and she was such a charming and such an encouraging.
We all miss her.
We miss her so much.
Oh, so you ran New York and you got injured running New York?
Apparently, I had a stress fracture when running. Somehow, I don't know, I have this thing, like, I run on stress fracture on New York City Marathon.
And what was your time for New York?
At that time, 3:15.
3:15, even though you had an unknown stress fracture.
Yes. Figured out I had a stress fracture. I went to the doctor, actually, when I started training for Boston in 2012.
Because you were hurting.
Hurting. I was never a winter runner before. So, and then I was out. So came back right after injury, so started running in June 2012. Then I ran Berlin, so I did Berlin 3:07.
Injury free. Okay.
So came back, and that's when it kept on giving, because I was PRing, like, every marathon I was running, I was PRing 5 minutes at least. So, and then Chicago, I was training for 3 hours, but I ended up doing 2:57.
2:57, excellent. And that was considered the fastest marathon time by a Nepalese woman?
Yes.
Ever?
Ever.
That qualified you to be invited to represent the marathon?
The big issue became, like, whether I was a Nepalese citizen or not, because I never ran. I was never an athlete or professional athlete or national player in Nepal.
Yeah.
So after all that, you know, and I was supposed to go to the qualifiers over there. Somehow that whole miscommunication thing happened. They did not let me know about the qualifiers until like 2 or 3 weeks before the qualifier, and I'm here in New York. So there were like all these things that I had to fight against, you know, and then get my through. But I had like some people who were supportive about it and supported, and somehow I kind of agreed. I was like, really, in Nepal it's a very hierarchy level too, but I sent them like a very clear note saying, like, this is what it is. I was supposed to, and it's not that you guys did not know that I'm in New York and I need at least like and marathon running is not like a mile. You just go and run for the qualifier, you know, you need time and preparation, especially for another altitude.
So
it basically, in the qualifier, nobody could get even closer to the time that I had in my last 4 or 5 marathon I ran. So, and that's how I ended up.
And they gave you this diploma?
So, yeah, in the Asian Games, this is the diploma. And there is a medal inside. So for participating, like, you know, the athlete, whoever, if you've completed your event, then we get one of these.
Swoops, can you share with us a little bit about the experience at the Asian Games for you?
It was completely different to what I was running marathon in United States or other countries, just as a recreational runner, because, like, all these marathon I was running, I was basically competing for myself, running just, like, you know, to beat my own time. But now I am running to represent my country. So I hadn't really run competitively to take down another runner since, like, I ran in, like, 100 meters, 200 meters in high school. So they were, like, a three major differences. I think, like, from my experience going there, one was I went to the Asian Games. Everybody was like a professional athlete. They have like a manager, they have sponsors, they have a coach, massage, they have their own massage people, they have their own physical therapist. I just went by myself. And I have my friend who also runs with me from Nikita, Quabs. I don't know if you know him. So Quabs was there to cheer for me, and my family was there, of course.
In Seoul, South Korea, okay.
That's where the Asian Games was. There were 45 countries in the Asian Games representing. And in the beginning, from what I know, like, we supposed to have like 40 or 35 people. So I was doing some research on some of the timing for each country. So I think, like, oh, there must, at least there may be some people who will be slower than me, you know, because I just did not want to be the, like, you know, coming to the marathon 1 hour, then everybody else had passed away. Because I looked at the, and then during the orientation and everything, I missed the orientation. Then I went to talk to the people over there, like what it takes, like to get the route information and everything. I looked at the chart of all the competitors, and the best time was the Japanese woman who is like very fat, Hakashi. So the best time was 2:23, 2:24.
Wow.
And among them, the slowest time was 2:45 or 2:47.
Okay.
My best time is 2:57.
You are too amateur among the professionals.
Yeah, exactly. It was very overwhelming for me. The first time ever I went to the starting line feeling nervous, that it felt like I have never ever raced them or run the marathon before. And another big difference that was we were not really supposed to carry anything with us because of the whole drug testing, and I'm always used to carry
water
we used to have in the course.
Oh, okay.
But gel and salt tablets, okay. That's like you're so dependent on them.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah.
So we had to leave them the day before, and they had the table for the country.
Oh, okay.
And there you pick it up them.
Okay.
But I've never raced as a professional, like, or elite before, so I do not have that experience. And also, like, pacing myself and starting, because all the other people, they have ran with each other before in all the other international competition, and I'm like new person over there. It was a big learning experience for me. So if I go next time or to run any competitive race, I know so much better.
But
it felt like I was running the marathon for the first time.
Okay.
Because it was totally different.
Of course.
And also, I have only raced big marathons, which is like 35,000 people, 40,000 people.
And how many people were here?
Over there, like, people backed out. So they were like 17 when I started. 17.
Oh, my goodness.
So you're basically running.
It was a training run, except these people were very, very fast.
Fast.
So what was your ultimate time?
I did 3 flat.
But 3 flat is darn good.
I was a little disappointed because I thought I wanted to break 3 at least. Even now I knew, like, once I knew I wouldn't be any close to any of them, but
yeah,
at least I thought I want to do sub-3.
Yeah.
Because I trained that marathon for 2:55, and I knew I was in the, but
okay,
I didn't know that I had the fracture at that time too.
You had another fracture that
time? No, the same thing.
In Korea, you had a fracture when you ran to 3.0.
Yeah, but I didn't know at that time, yeah.
Oh, okay. So that's been very exciting. You get to travel. You Berlin, you said, Chicago, Marine Corps, Washington, work in New York. Any other exotic places did you go to?
I did Tokyo Marathon.
Tokyo,
yeah,
too.
Tokyo Marathon.
That's very hard to get in.
Yeah, I applied lottery and that was all, like, my 2013 fall to 2014 has been my golden year, I guess.
Okay, Tokyo.
So every race, even Tokyo, I went there thinking that I would run it as a training run for Boston, but
okay,
then I ended running 2:59.
2:59 in Tokyo.
Yeah.
Excellent. What are some of your future challenges that you have for yourself?
So during New York City Marathon last year, 2014,
yeah,
I I snapped my fibula on my right leg.
Your fibula?
Yeah. So it's like the bone right here.
Okay, you snapped it. You were running and snapped.
I guess so, because I might have stress fracture even before I went Asian Games.
And now, did you finish New York regardless?
I did. That is my only experience of finishing a race feeling like terrible.
You did finish?
Yeah, I did finish.
What time did you finish?
3:06.
3:06 with one leg. Oh my goodness.
I'm still doing physical therapy.
Do you have another destination marathon?
I want to run one good marathon this year, but I'm still thinking which one to do.
Now, and you're still a lone wolf? You still just run with Nike? Do you run with any teams?
No, actually, I was never officially affiliated with any team because Nike is open, you do not really have
a... The shirt is Nepal. Is that for the Asian Games?
Yeah, that's my country. This is the Nepalese flag, and this is the Nepal shirt.
And, of course, Nike is Swoops.
So, it's nice.
Okay, so that's the Asian Games shirt.
Sure.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Well, I have a feeling a lot of people are going to be calling you to be on their team.
Yeah, actually, no. Last day in New York City Marathon, Coach Kane. So I ran with Coach Kane. So now...
Jonathan Kane.
With
City Sports.
City Coach, yeah.
City Coach.
Yeah.
Oh,
so City Coach. So I ran for City Coach, the New York City. That's the first ever race I ran. With a team attached. But I think I'll be running, I don't know what races so far that I'm going to run this year. So depending on how I feel and how fast I can get back.
Well, listen, on that note, I see a very, very bright future for you.
Thank you.
This is an amazing story of true grit, of overcoming injuries, staying focused with your work, staying connected with everybody, making new friends, and that is so wonderful to hear. So I see wonderful things in your future.
Thank you so much.
It was
a pleasure. Thank you.